the hijab? Absolutely. Absolutely. They did it in Tunis. They did it in Turkey. They violated Sharia big time. But to say that the minimum age of marriage is 16, that's okay. Now, the question is, how do we deal with the issue of children who deviated from the Islamic proper ways of marriage, of respect for their elders? How do we deal with those children? Now, we have to first accept that not every problem has an easy solution, or not every problem has a solution, because sometimes, God forbid, if we discover cancer after it had become in stage 4, we can't do anything. It's too late. Even if we go to the best surgeons of the world, it's too late. And there are cases where the children have gone way far from where they are expected to be, and the answer is, it may be too late. You can't do anything about it. But if it is still, open for talking, the first thing I said, open for talking, because the starting point in everything is to re-establish communication, even though we are so angry with them. Many parents, when they reach a point where they are so angry with what their children did, you know what they do? They say, we are disowning you. You are not my son, I'm not your father. You leave the house, you don't come here, and I don't want to see your face again. This is not Islam. I can tell you immediately, you violated the rules of Islam big time. You can't say that. You cannot say that. Even Nuh, to the last minute, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him about the son, that he is to be min al-mughraqeen, he said, Ya Allah, but he is my son. I love him so much. He didn't say, I'm going to disown him. He said, Ya Allah, please. The same thing, never, break communication with your child now, and you've got to accept your share of the responsibility. That you've got to say, it was my mistake when he was 3 years old, 4 years old, 5 years old, 10 years old. He said, Baba, I want this. Okay, pick from my hand. Okay, I'll give you that. Baba, I want. Okay, anytime. And now, he got used to getting everything because you were the giver. When he become on his own, or at an age where he's embarrassed to keep on asking, now he will get what he wants through different ways. And that's when he may do or she may do things that are not right, and that's you may discover after the fact, and you start to curse him when I'm sorry to say, you should be angry with yourself. You're the one responsible for what he did. And we will talk about that. And sometimes there is a rule in Islam that says, كَمَا تَدِينُ تُدَانُ. That sometimes your son will behave with you in a way that is similar to the way you behaved with your parents. Even after some time, and now they are dead, and you stop thinking about the details, and you forgot, and now your son is behaving. Stop and ask yourselves, how did I behave? How did I treat my parents? What did I do? And it doesn't always have to be, exactly symmetrical in that. No, it could be that you did something to your parents, you deprived them of the visits that would have added happiness to their lives. you did this, you did this, so your son will deal with you to show you how much he dislikes you. We will talk about all of that, inshallah, in detail. فاحذروه. In what way? This is saying that some of your spouses and your children may actually be enemies for you. In what way? In what way? They may be enemies for you on the day of judgment. That it is understood in both ways. One way is to say that you become so disillusioned about everything unless it is through them. Your wife would sway you from coming to the masjid. You know, don't go, you are going every day, and you know, today I'm going to blah, blah, blah. Okay, I'm not going to the masjid. Okay, or your wife said, you know, we have to go and visit some people, and you stay till 12 midnight. You do not wake up for Fajr because you did something that is not, I'm not blaming my sisters here, saying that they are responsible for that. It could be the other way around. And I know many examples where the husbands do the same thing, where they do the same thing. So they become enemies. And also, they may be your enemies if you do not treat them according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to do, they will turn to be your enemies. Yes, brother. I can identify, I would say, 60% of the problems to be from the overall picture, because we are not living in isolation. Some of the problems is that the wife insisting on leaving the house to work outside, even though the husband is capable to support the family. They come home, they are tired, they don't want to talk to each other, you know, and they start to fight. Or the wife is spending all her money on her wardrobe, or the wife demanding to live in a mansion and the husband is unable to afford that because now my friend, her husband bought her a five-car garage and this and that. So I want this and I want, these are things that are common to the, you know, society at large. But the unique 40% characteristics are we brought the wife from back home, the wife and the husband's level of education are not compatible. Families, and this is uniquely us, our families, we the families, we interfere big time in the lives of the newlyweds. And you see, we feel that we've got to, as we say, an amn alayhum, which means we want to make sure that we would deliver them into good hands. So they have to tell, okay, he eats his food like this, he wakes up at this time. Leave them to wake up and eat anything. Don't interfere in their lives. This is something that is uniquely us, our culture. In this culture here, they just basically let go. Okay? And I'm not saying that they are better than us. We are proud of having an extended family, but we've got to understand that Islamically, we should let go. You know that story, I don't know how many of you knew the story, where a woman's husband, newlywed, her husband went on a journey, and before he left, he said, I ask you not to leave the house for any reason until I come. This is what I want. And he left. And while she was at home and he was away, her brother came And he said, your father is very ill. You may want to go and see him. He's really ill. She said, but my husband told me not to leave. You know, I can't. So he went. He came back again. And he said, your father is getting really bad. Okay, she said, I'm sorry. My husband told me not to leave. I'm not going to leave. Not that because he didn't love their father. But because look how now a new family, there are rules that we are not familiar with today. Today, when two people get married, they learn marriage, or they will never learn marriage according to Islamic perspective at all. If they learn it by trial and error, or they learn part of it. That's why I have been asking Sheikh Jamal that we should demand that any couple who wants to get married should go through a workshop that we will do 3 times a year, for example. That they should attend this workshop to learn the rights and responsibilities, you know, what to say, what to do, all of these things. There are certain things that can be included in the marriage contract that people don't know. And many, I would say 99% of people, they just basically take the generic contract and they sign it. And they don't even read what's in it. Where Islam allowed the woman so many additions to put in the marriage contract that people don't know. They don't understand it. They don't know these things. That is legal. But there are social issues, religious issues, and you name it. So this woman, after some time, her brother said, your father passed away. Now, you have to come. She said, please go to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and ask him, you know, if I could leave my house, and please tell him what my husband said to me. So her brother went to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and told him. He said, you know, if she would fulfill her husband's wish, Allah will turn that into rahamat, forms of mercy on her father, and would shower his blessings on the couple because of her accept or her obeying or going by the wishes of her husband. Look how it is that you know, the newlyweds now are forming a niche on their own. Now, I am sorry, this is the first halaqah I'm giving, so I don't know the etiquette. I don't intend to keep anybody beyond. We've been talking for, you know, an hour and a half. So unless you have any question or anything, you may want to prepare for Salat al-Isha. Is there a yes? How I look at it, I tell them I need at least 4 months of meeting with both of them to teach that person Islam, or if he already knows a little bit about Islam, I want to be satisfied that this person genuinely is